Poor silly girl. Yes, he does.
Yes, it is. This is my cat, Bryony.
Oh, he's a big one.
That's a girl. Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Michael.
GinA.
Nice to meet you.
And your Priscilla.
Yes. My hand's got that.
Hi. This is Bryony. This is my girl cat. I have a boy cat outside. He hates being inside, so he goes out and the cat. That'll probably be knocking at my door here soon.
Yeah.
Puts my curtain, the magnets.
Yeah.
Kind of knock against my door. Okay. Edward wants to come in.
That's what mine would do. He would come and scratch on the on the door.
So she's very friendly. She'll make
that's
friends
okay.
with you if that's okay with you.
I'll make friends with her.
They're my buddies.
I share my house with her. You know how
yeah.
it is, you know? Yeah, they don't share my house. I share their house.
Yeah.
Well, I'm more of a cat person than a dog person because dogs are like, I need you, I need you, I need you. And cats are like, don't call me.
Yeah.
More independent.
Yeah. I compare cats and dogs to toddlers and teenagers. Dogs are very much like toddlers, always needing discipline, always needing guidance, always needing boundaries, always needing supervision. Can't be left alone for any period of time because they'll get into trouble. And then you've got cats. You can leave alone for 3 or 4 days as long as they have food, water, a poop box,
that's what I,
a way to look outside, and they'll be happy.
That's what we used to do with my cat when we went to upstate New York down to visit my mom, and then big old bowl of food.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean he was happy to be home alone. Now he let me know all about it.
Yes, they usually do.
I was telling Priscilla a little bit about what you had shared with me on the way over. I was telling her what you had shared with me on the phone about some of the stuff you had been through and which...
See the paperwork behind you? All is legal. And each pile is a different case. And most of them are housing. Or the result of a housing issue.
But this was the agreement that we made in court.
So my understanding of the way they do evictions right now, and I'm going to walk through it and just correct me if I'm wrong. You got there, they called your name, they made you go to mediation. You went to mediation. It was unsuccessful. The landlord did not want to negotiate. So you went back into court, and you told him about your affirmative defense, and he said, well, geez, maybe I really should play nice. And he made you this offer.
Well, I stood up in court and told the judge I wanted to raise.
So you got the judge involved, which scared the landlord. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then the landlord ran off and got his attorney. Mm-hmm. And
because after that, the judge did allow us to go and talk about it. He said, well, I'm going to let y'all go out. He warned the landlord that I could get him for retaliation.
And you still can.
Okay.
You still can, okay? Now, let me just hold off on that. So the landlord gets his attorney. They come back. They offer you $1,000 if you'll leave by October 5th. You say yes, okay. The judge orders
it.
Well, yeah, it was like that, but I could have gotten more.
Negotiation?
I could have got more, but I was like, and I think that's why, like you were saying, that what you said, I hadn't even looked at it that way when you said that he
kind of
the intimidation and everything. I didn't really think of it because, yeah, he did try to get me to change the thing, but what was the point I was getting? Because what was your question and answer?
The date. How did you come up with the end date? What kind of negotiations were involved in that?
Well, the widow possession was for October 5th, and then he asked if we would leave in a week, if we would leave it the end of the month, September 30th.
And this is important, okay, this was signed on September 21st, so, and giving you 10-5, okay. So, on what, he came on September 30th, you said, or the last day, with
31st,
and forced you out. So, between the 21st and the 30th, what date, as close as you can remember, did he ask you to move out on the
last day? He did that before. See, that's what, okay.
This is all, it will explain this if you go to here.
Okay.
This agreement that was attached.
Yeah.
That would explain it more to you, I think.
I forgot to tell you, it was two pieces.
It's okay. I'm not good at. She's like a child. She is like a child. When I have company or when I'm on the phone, she has to be right in the middle of things. Okay, plaintiff to appear.
She's got a really nice coat.
I try to feed them as good food as I can. I buy a can for holistic cat food, which is as good as I can get without spending $20 a bag. By agreement. Settlement agreement attached and incorporated. Okay. So this is the agreement that was attached and incorporated. Okay. So when they say that when it's incorporated, it becomes part of the actual order.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah, and she acted. And I had also noticed that she actually.
And all this handwriting was part of the order that was before the judge ordered it.
And she even actually, even if you look at the other piece here,
mm-hmm.
if you look back at this, because I've looked over this so much, the little things I've noticed. Judgment is rendered, and it says by agreement.
Mm-hmm.
And then she then went ahead, and judgment is granted to the plaintiff for possession of five, but then made sure she put other, because my question.
And she had to put other so that she could make reference to this other agreement.
Exactly.
Otherwise, she would have had to write the agreement in the actual specific agreement details in here to incorporate it into. To incorporate into the order, because everything in law, as I'm sure you're probably learning, if it's not written down, it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And if you don't write it down or get video or audio or photos, it didn't happen and it doesn't exist. And that's in regards to your question about appellate court. Everything that you want the court to look at or to consider for evidence or facts must be entered at this stage before you appeal, okay? So you can, there is a lot of things that you can do with this. Let's just take it one step at a time. Let me finish reading this.
On that note that you just mentioned about everything having to be in writing, the excuse that he used was it didn't say how I had to. He's saying that the court order it didn't specify that he had to pay me like in cash, even though it's got a dollar sign and it says pay. And
I'm sure the court did not mean
and
an
it
IOU.
Says at that time. The other thing that
at the time upon surrender permits, okay, it does specify, and the fact that he did not render full payment of $1,000 to you. He is now in contempt of court order.
Yeah, no one's done nothing about
okay.
it.
I've
told the judge
you
that.
You have to file a motion for contempt. And this
See,
is
so
where I...
This is where I need your help, because I can go into court and tell a judge that, but he won't
Correct.
Tell me to do this.
He won't. He can't.
Yeah.
Because it borders on legal advice.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Your next option is to file a motion for contempt. And that's why I suggested that you print off your rules of civil procedure. Every option available to you is in the rules of civil procedure. And it's tricky about evictions, because evictions are, the district court has original jurisdiction, which means the eviction must be brought in district court first. And then if you read rules of procedure, which is actually rule 80D, Brian, I need you to get down, sweetheart. I know, Brian.
Yeah, I even had questions about the jurisdiction issue.
Yeah.
I felt like that might be a good way to argue.
Flip over to rule 80D. And it says in there that forcible entry detainers cannot be joined with any other type of action. So he cannot sue you for any kind of alleged rent arrearage or anything else, nor can you sue him during the forcible entry detainer action. As a matter of fact, any civil case that you have against him as a result of the eviction or even prior to the eviction has to be brought in a separate action.
Maybe it started that process yet.
And now we're going to talk about that in a minute because... Go ahead.
Now the question I have is, have I waited too long?
Well, let me read this here. If the defendants have vacated prior to, were you living with him at the time? So you were a tenant also.
We were both listed.
Okay, you were both listed.
We all signed.
All right, so he did. Okay. If the defendants have vacated prior to Friday, September 30th. What's that location? 6 p.m. Oh, 6 p.m., okay.
And they were there, 6 p.m. that night.
Parties agree that the judgment will be vacated.
And that word, that right there.
Dismissed without prejudice. And the plaintiff, see, without prejudice, see, with prejudice and without prejudice. Without prejudice means he can bring this action again. With prejudice means he can never raise the eviction against you for this property, for this tenancy again.
That's what it says.
It doesn't, okay. So it doesn't mean that I can't sue him?
No. That does not mean you cannot sue him. Without prejudice means that he
only
can...
Only by him against me in the case that we're
action.
Dealing with.
Right, with just the eviction
okay.
for that unit.
Okay.
Okay? It's limited to that specific action by that individual against that individual. So, let's say if my lawsuits were just dismissed improperly, but let's say if the judge hypothetically had dismissed them with prejudice, which they didn't, if she had done that, then I would be forever prevented from raising those issues against those people ever again, because the judge put a prejudice against me, saying with prejudice meaning you can never raise this issue again. So without prejudice means that if you had not vacated, moved out on the 30th, he could then refile another eviction against you to get you out. If
well, because he broke that agreement, then that made that non and void. It breached that agreement.
Correct.
So then we really had October 5th at that point.
That's correct. Because he did not have the full $1,000 for you. He breached the agreement.
So he's in contempt, but is that technically considered a breach of contract, which makes it null and void?
It's actually more serious in my non-legal opinion. It's okay. More serious than a breach of contract because he violated a court order.
Ordered. That's what I kept saying.
It's a felony.
And I even looked
it's
that
a court
up.
Or it's a contempt charge.
That's right.
Charge.
Any agreement in Maine is considered a court
yeah.
order.
Now your biggest hurdle. Is going to be his political status in the community. Is overcoming his political status.
He's the liquor man.
Okay.
He owns the biggest liquor.
He used to be a selectman.
In...
That's my point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's going to be your biggest.
Why does that come into play?
Nepotism, favors, my hand in your pocket, your hand in my pocket.
Like
you do
say.
Me a favor, I'll do you a favor. Red Barn Restaurant down here. I'm sure you've heard of Red Barn Restaurant. I grew up with those people. Okay. And I know Laura personally. I know her family. I had a crush on her little brother, Ronnie. The district attorney for Kennebec County and the attorney general personally assisted Laura Benedict to get her 501c3 certificate so that she could raise money for her restaurant by doing charity work with the community. The AG and the district attorney. Help a private restaurant get their fucking 501c3 certificate.
I was thinking about going in. Governor LePage always has the open door policy.
Yeah, you have to pay for it.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. I have friends who got meetings with him. You have to pay for each meeting. $15, like 20 minutes.
Well, I'll take $15. That's what I have to pay your ass. See your ass. I'll pay
yeah.
your ass.
But, you know, then you got to look at it. Like she was just saying, it's...
Well, you know.
It's who knows who. And you know what? I understand that because I come from a background where you take care of things yourself. And so me stepping out of my juvenile mindset from growing up in a boys' home, you know,
mm-hmm.
and having and coming from what I, and then having to go back to that as an adult, taking this path, it kind of discouraged me in a way in believing, because I went into this thinking, wow, man, I'm gonna do it the right way this time, you know. And I know about making myself familiar with the law. I've been charged with crimes. I was charged. First one that ever came against me was assault on a police officer, and he lied because he tripped chasing me.
And he was too embarrassed.
And was too embarrassed to admit it because he'd had to pay out of his pocket for scraping his knee or whatever he did.
Oh, he would have gotten workers' comp. He was on duty. He was chasing a suspect. He would have gotten workers' comp.
Yeah, but just
so
the same.
The way,
embarrassment. Yeah.
The way I got that taken care of was that I sent my lawyer, my court-appointed lawyer, and just told him, man, all you have to do is this. Just go there and find the people that work that night and get them to write a statement
mm-hmm.
that's going to be binding in court. And then bring them back to me. And he did it, and he brought them back and said, now, do either one of those statements say anything about me striking that officer? And he looked at him again. He said, no, they don't. I said, there you go. Now, what are they going to do? Change their story now? So, So I've learned that's how it is. And I don't have a problem with that. But, you know, if I can understand little things. But this is just blatant. This is like
constant. The lawyer that we got to handle this.
This is civil rights.
Once they arrested him for criminal trespass and disorderly conduct, he called our lawyer, that lawyer that helped us out, and never got back to him. Went to Pine Tree Legal. Yeah. I mean, that was crazy.
You know what? And I'm here to really try to absorb as much as I can from you. And so if I'm getting off on something and you want to redirect it, please feel free.
That's fine. But thank you, because it law is very complicated. Law is like a spider web.
But
okay?
like Kim,
you've got a core, which is the core issue. But affecting that core issue, you've got laws, rules, immunity, okay, contributory negligence, any kind of contributory responsibility. You've got all kinds of factors that play into what happens with that core issue. So
can I ask you a real quick question? And you can, I'll wait.
I'll scan this while you're
one of my about. Biggest one of you know what my biggest thing is you this is what I want more than anything, and this is going to be the stickler. This, like I told her, it would take me years to be able to pull it off, and I believe I have to ask the judicial, the Justice Department before I can even do it. But I really want to go after the police department.
You can do that.
I really, really want
well,
them
you know
because
what?
Because I believe that they knowingly.
Did you hear? I don't know.
I promised that officer that he better know the law.
Because how can they can't trust? Because
I told him I'm gonna learn it. I'm not from here, but I'll learn it.
I mean.
And he didn't read me my Miranda rights. Mm-mm. And in the video, you can see my landlord standing in my doorway.
And that was something you said, video. Who was running the video camera? Really?
Cops.
Cops were running. Oh, so you got the... You got
the funny thing is, not all... No. This is the other thing. My evidence that they've given me...
There should have been three videos.
Like there should have been more cops videos. And the other thing is, one of the 911 calls, as soon as he tells her what's going on, and there's a fight and everything, blah, blah, blah. And he starts to explain. She goes, okay, hold on. Okay, stay on the line. And you never hear any more of the call. So another question I had for you on it was when they give me a disclosure and I request the evidence that they're going to submit at trial, do they have to submit like all the police video, or do they just have to submit what they're going to use against me?
Can they hold back
that 911 part of that 911 call?
No, exculpatory evidence. If you look up Black's Law exculpatory evidence, let me pull it up for you because I don't want to misparaphrase.
Well, first of all,
so if I can prove that,
they have to produce every piece of evidence that will either prove your innocence or prove your guilt. All right, that was how I got my criminal charges dismissed. Is I stood firmly on my demand for evidence. I demanded video, I demanded audio, and they refused to give it to me. And so when they pushed me all the way to a trial, I had a jury waiting for me in the next room. That was how far they pushed me. Got me into the courtroom all dressed up for my trial. And then they dismissed 6 of the 7 charges and put me on deferred, and coerced me actually into a deferred disposition for the 7th charge, even though I had an appeal pending. See, these little fuckers are slimy, okay? They are. They're slimy.
Yeah, we know.
Let me tell you. On December 5th, 2013, I was heard on a motion to dismiss my criminal charges. It was the 3rd motion to dismiss that I had filed. They denied my motion to dismiss the criminal charges, 7 of them. I appealed the denial to the Supreme Court, okay? Legally, according to rules of appellate procedure and rules of civil procedure and criminal procedure, nothing else is allowed to happen in court against me for those charges while my appeal is pending. No agreements, no judgments, nothing. Everything stops dead. Not in my case. On December 5th, I appealed the denial of my motion to dismiss. December 17th, they said, are you ready for trial? I said, I have an appeal pending. They said, you're going to trial tomorrow. I said, well, you guys need to dismiss these charges if you don't want to, you know, play with me for the next 7 years. No, we're going forward. So I go into the Superior Court in Augusta on December 18th. 12, 13 people are waiting in the jury room, waiting for me to start my trial. The DA says, oh, we're going to dismiss 6 of the 7 charges. Really? I just asked you to dismiss them yesterday, and I got an appeal pending on a denial of dismissal from 2 weeks ago. No, we're going to dismiss them. Why? Well, because the officer on 4 of the charges died early this year. Really? When did he die? April. And we're now December. Did you know about this? Yeah. And you're just now telling me about it? Really? Okay. So this is December 2013. Not knowing as much then as I don't know now, I allowed them to force me into a deferred disposition. You understand what that is?
So you don't get no trouble again for years, and they dismiss
the charge, right?
Yeah.
So not knowing really what I was doing, and my court-appointed useless attorney was going right along with them, never said a word about the appeal, just let them railroad me right into this, right? So they dismissed 6 of the 7 charges.
Your court-appointed attorney did?
Of course. He tried to get me to plead guilty to 3 of the charges. I told him to pound sand. This was a few months earlier, but anyway. So the court coerces me into this deferred disposition, which I agreed to. And then I go home, and a week or so later, I realize what had happened. I'm like, wait a minute, this isn't cool. So I rescinded my agreement. I actually filed a rescission of my agreement. They rejected my rescission. Sorry, you can't reject somebody's rescission on a contract. I rescind my agreement, period. It was a fraudulent agreement. I was coerced. I had an appeal pending. You had no right to do this. No, sorry, the deferred disposition stands. You're on it for a year. So I appealed it to the Supreme Court.
So this is what you meant when you told me earlier. Get
prepared
for your appeal.
Because
the district's going to pretty much bend me over in that court, and I'm going to have to go fight it on a higher level.
Yes.
That's what I was telling you.
Yes.
You got to keep,
fighting in the main court is actually just a preliminary step to really fighting it the right way. You really have to fight it in the federal court, but you can't get to the federal court unless you file your own civil rights case. The main state court violates your civil rights in such a way that you have a right to bring it to the federal court. Because as we know, federalism calls for a division, a complete division between the federal courts and the state courts. Federal courts are not allowed to review state court decisions except in very limited circumstances, and only when federal issues are at stake. Okay, I've been dealing with this for over a year now. I've got so many cases in federal court now, it's not funny. So, but it's a mess. And you are going to get bent over.
Well, what about arguing the jurisdiction under sovereign? Because it's
Don't even use the word sovereign in any of your arguments. In terms of like sovereign citizen, sovereign. No.
Well, what I mean is, as a citizen, because I'm an American. And I answer to that law first by our own laws.
Me too. You just, I don't know. You know what this flag is?
No, I don't.
This is originally called the Betsy Ross flag.
It's the first 13, but I've never seen it with the three. Is that a Roman numeral 3?
Yeah, and it symbolizes 3%ers. They're called 3-1ers or 3%ers. Back when, I can't remember which war it was, 3% of the colonists is all it took to overthrow the government. That's what this 3% represents,
okay.
Is that anybody who represents himself as a 3-1er is somebody who will truly stand up against the government and do what's right. Okay, there's not many people who will truly do what's right. A 3-1er...
Well, that's because that's another question I had for you.
I'm sovereign. And I started arguing sovereignty back in 2012 when I started my legal mess. Don't even whisper the word, okay?
You make it worse.
Oh God, yeah.
Because it's like you're offending. It's like you're slapping the state in the face and saying you ain't nobody.
Well, as you know, the courts are corporate. Everything's corporate now.
Yeah.
It's not constitutional.
I just learned that today, Monroe.
Okay. It's all corporate. It's all money. This is your Bible. Learn the rules of procedure. This is where your
main
power
rules
is.
The civil procedure.
I went through it and I found all the ones. I think it's in here. I may have it in my notes.
Just don't print them out.
But
you should invest in some money and have it printed out.
Yeah.
If you have a printer or if you have somebody who can print them off.
I've been reading the criminal procedure.
Yep.
When
the landlord came over that day to do that agreement, he brought self-help. He brought guys and goons, big guys. And
it was meant to intimidate.
And then he went to go throw their mattress out, and then he punched Michael and everything. And the cops didn't get there until after the fight was all over.
And the cops... basically useless unless they see something. They can
They looked at this paperwork. They knew that. I mean, how can you arrest him for criminal trespassing when we had the right to be there? Because the landlord.
Because the agreement said.
But they didn't.
Doesn't matter. His contempt of the court order is a civil issue that you have to take up with the courts. As far as the cop is concerned, you were supposed to be out. That's all the cop wanted to know. It's all he was concerned about. It's 6 p.m. September 3rd. You're out. If you're not out, you're a criminal trespasser.
But if the agreement was not void, then we still had to October 5th.
But the cop is stupid. Cops are stupid. The cops don't know the law.
Can we argue the point that we still had to October 5th there?
Yes, because he breached the because he breached the judgment. But that you need to bring up in a motion for contempt, okay?
Another part of the argument is, nobody in their right mind would believe that cop did not realize that they were committing an illegal eviction. And the other
Westbrook cops have been chastised and I think even disciplined for helping landlords illegally evict tenants who cannot be properly evicted to the eviction court. There are landlords in Westbrook who evicted a couple of people a few years ago using the trespassing law to get them out because they couldn't, because the landlord couldn't get them out any other way.
See, that's even by our our stand.
Do the cops have a right to force us to leave?
According to this, yes. According to this, based on what they know and based on what they've been taught, yes. He thought he was doing the right thing. Because this order here says September 3rd, 6 p.m.
But
the landlord's breach of the contract is no consequence to the cop. He doesn't care about that. That's between you and the landlord in the courtroom, not on the street.
All right, so what happens to the disorderly then? Because
you need all of those criminal charges dismissed.
My question, my thing is, he and the landlord and the police officer committed an illegal eviction.
Correct.
So
how can it be illegal eviction if you're telling me that?
Because police are not taught
to do that.
Police are not taught eviction law, okay? First of all. Secondly, police today are mindless, brainless robots.
Actually, I think it says they can't do that. Sheriffs are supposed to do that.
That's correct. And that was another thing I wanted to bring up to you. Local police are not enforcers. The sheriff was the one to enforce that.
So that's where it makes it.
That's where his power is. That's where
it's illegal
power is, okay?
Eviction.
Because that cop
had no right to do that.
Had no right. He was not the enforcer of the word of possession.
That's what
he
I meant
was
by
there
jurisdiction.
For disorderly.
Okay. Now, that doesn't go into jurisdiction between departments?
But that's not a court jurisdiction issue. That's
okay.
That's something between you and the police department. Okay, you have several issues going on here. You have an issue between you and the landlord, an issue between you and his goons, an issue between you and the police officers who arrived for the disorderly conduct, who arrested you and forced you out of your home that you had a legal right to stay in. Okay, they used the criminal law to get you out of your home. And the landlord did it on purpose. He gave you an IOU.
He's on camera going in, asking him what's going on. And he tells him he needs to be out of here today. And you know what I found in the law? In the consumer guide, it says a landlord cannot ask a police officer.
Do you mind if I use my medicine?
Oh, no, we smoke, too. I have my cart. We
That's
have our cart, too.
That's why I'm not in Texas anymore.
Yeah, right?
Down there, they'll hang you.
Oh, my God.
We've got an expression down there that says, come on vacation, leave on probation.
Yeah.
But chapter 14,
yeah.
This is, I don't know if I have it written down. I'll just read it because it's kind of sloppy. But it says, in chapter 14, I guess it's, what is it called, section 8, or if it's got a point. 8 next to it, right here. Maine Consumer Law Guide.
Mm-hmm.
A landlord cannot ask a police officer to issue a criminal trespass warrant. And that's in the Maine.
Okay, well, let me pull that up then.
And he's standing in that trailer on that video, and John Bouvier is talking to him like he used to be an old selectman. And as a matter of fact, this guy started... The sergeant that made the decision,
mm-hmm.
he started his career when he was a selectman. and I'm not, if I'm not mistaken, this is another question we've had. Are selectmen the ones that determine who advances in rank in the police department?
The selectmen are in control of the police, yeah.
Yeah.
So he used to be his boss, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
His boss came by and told him.
That's why I was saying, yeah.
So his old boss came by. And told him here, break the law, and it says in the consumer guide, you can't ask that.
I'm gonna go after their asses. What they did? They made us live in a car for a month.
Real quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Real quick.
Ran us through hell.
Before I forget again, okay? First of all, I really appreciate what you're doing, and the second thing is, I'm pretty sure you've experienced retaliation because this determines whether I'm getting into it. Because if I'm gonna get into this, I ain't just getting into it for me. I'm gonna get into it. Because something needs to be done about this. This is not right, not just for us. It's for the whole
Well, I can tell you that if you fight them, if you stand up for yourself, they're going to kick you as hard as they can, as long as they can.
Now, what I'm talking about is vigilante, because I've already been dealt with. I've already been dealt with by this guy, and he brought, I believe it's a karate guy over, and I pretty much embarrassed them.
Then what I would suggest...
Start... Video or surveillance, everything. Because that's the only mistake I made. If I had video of what he did when he came out that door and started swinging on
me. I didn't even expect us to happen. I thought,
when you
got a witness that was there.
When you go home and settle in and feel like taking an hour to watch a video, you should go out to my personal YouTube page. And actually, I think my main tenant's YouTube page also. View the video of me getting evicted last May. Three sheriffs kicked in the door to my house that I bought. I purchased this house, and the seller conspired with his attorney and the court to kick me out of the house that I purchased. And they sent three sheriffs to kick my door down and throw me out of my house. And I caught it all on video because I knew it was going to happen. I surveilled them, and I got them all on video. My point is, vigilantism, I've been able to prevent them from coming after me by making it very, very public that I record everything. And they know it because I put it on my YouTube channel for them to see, and I send them a link to it.
That's, you know what, when I didn't know what that was. When I saw it popped up, and believe me, today, I really needed it. It popped up, and I listened to it, and I was like, and then when you told me that you weren't, it made even more sense of how, it made it even funnier when I found out that you're not like a lawyer. And the way that,
I hate lawyers.
The way that they angled it. So they called you to see if you would mess up by acting like they were wanting to help you. See how freaking clever they are? They're
like
snakes,
man.
They
almost got me that day, okay? As soon as I got that call, I don't remember why I didn't answer. I must have been away from the computer or something, but the message came in, I heard the message, and I got all excited, and I called my friend, who's much older than me and has a lot more experience in the legal community, and we brainstormed about it, and she says, Gina, stop and think for a minute. Why would the Attorney General's office be calling a brand new startup manned by one person for legal advice about an issue they deal with hundreds of times a day? That's a good point. Okay. Oh, I see what they're trying to do. Okay. So then I formulated my response, and then I called them back, which is what you heard. So I had a chance to think about what I was going to say before I called back. But they're really slimy. They never called me back. They haven't called me since.
See, this is what I meant by the retaliation. All right?
It is.
When I started trying to find help on the internet, I was amazed.
I know it's emotional.
I'm from a state where, okay, so the reason I'm asking you this is because, yeah, I have to record everything because they'll.
And I am recording just
that's
so
okay.
You know.
I'm fine with that. Please
okay.
Do. But
it helps me take notes. It helps me reflect on what you said.
I have no problem with that.
So much comes out.
I come from a state where, in Houston, when I lived there, all right, I used to tattoo as black people, all right, that were in the underground rap industry. And
sativa.
Oh, yes.
But the crime lab in Houston, this is how wicked they were willing to be. They begin to falsify the DNA reports and put, especially black guys, they were putting them on death row, and some of them, they didn't find out about it before some of them had gone. And so it's a big place in my heart because that's just horrible to think that's, and for me, I'm watching what's happening. They can sit up there and act like on their high horses like, oh, we're being just, but eventually there's going to be so many people that are fed up with it. It's going to get ugly.
It's getting ugly now.
Yeah, with all the Occupy stuff that's going on.
It's getting ugly now. Let me show you what I'm able to do. Do you know what it means to when a judge recuses himself? Do you know what the word recuse means?
No.
Recuse means a judge recognizes that he or she has the conflict of interest and cannot be impartial or fair over the case. Okay.
They want to dismiss themselves from that case.
Yeah. Let me show you.
And what was the word again?
Recuse. R-E-C-U-S-E.
Well, associated with playing pool.
The top one,
Judge Torrenson, she's the chief judge of the United States District Court for Maine. She's the supervising judge of all the other judges in the federal court. She recused herself from my case.
And why? What was the reason that she gave?
And Judge Niverson, he came from the Maine State Courts. He was one of the judges who presided over the criminal cases that I got dismissed.
No,
he was one of the judges that denied my dismissal.
That's why
and he did the preliminary review of my lawsuit against the state judges.
So he can't have nothing to do with
so
it.
So these are like trophies.
Oh, absolutely. They're trophies. For a pro se, for somebody who does not have an attorney, to get a chief judge treat not only once, this is just one of them. I got to recuse myself twice.
So what I'm looking at right now.
But that pisses them off. Okay?
Yeah.
Because if you think about it, if you get right down to quantum mechanics of it, you've got these judges and these attorneys who have spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on their education and their occupation to get where they're at and to know what they know and to do what they do. Also, they have to pay to do all of their court work, okay? When a landlord evicts the tenant, $75 just to get the complaint. Another $70 for the writ of possession. Okay? $400 for a motion. All right? Big bucks. Not for me and him.
That's the thing.
Because we're disabled.
Yeah, cases are
and we receive dental assistance and other types of welfare. And the state of Maine in 1995 issued an administrative order that said all people who receive any kind of general assistance or welfare or any kind of income-based assistance is automatically eligible to proceed without paying the fees, which means you can go all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States without paying a pending court fees. You have to pay for your copies, and you have to pay, you know, to
for the minor
post
little
it,
things.
The minor stuff, but the $400 promotion, $150 for this,
yeah,
$500
for that.
That's $300 what discourages
jury people.
Fee. Absolutely. Absolutely.
That was a
good, done for a reason.
Then who put that in place?
Done for a reason.
Who was
the
guy? Who did you say put that in place here in Maine?
Just a judge.
A judge?
Yeah, a chief judge many years ago recognized.
Try to discourage people from doing all that.
The fees to file. If you go out to the court's website, well, actually right here, they have...
I thought you brought something up like that the other day.
They have...
$400, all that money on there.
Yeah, how much money it is. But see, what I'm wondering is, they have to pay, like, when you're being prosecuted by the county, the district attorney has to pay all that? Who pays for... So the district attorney's coming after me because for $100, because district attorneys don't take loss.
Just to save face, that's all, okay? My deferred disposition, they held on to me for a year. All other deferred dispositions almost always have a supervisory fee that the defendant has to pay, plus they have to do community service of some kind and pay some kind of end charge, $100, $200, whatever, okay? That's usually how a deferred disposition goes. Me, no community service, no supervisory fees, no penalties, no fees, nothing. Just wait, sit down for a year, be a good girl for a year, and then we'll let you go. They didn't make a penny from me, but they had to save face. So they kept me tangled up in the courts for 365 days on probation or on conditional release, deferred disposition, which forced me to tell the police officer, anytime I had any kind of interaction with a police officer, that I was on deferred disposition. So I'm scared to death for an entire year of calling the police for help, because even if I'm the one calling for help, I have to say, hey, I'm on deferred disposition. So it automatically makes me look bad in their eyes, you know? So the courts did this to me for a year. And you know why? Because I was a good little girl and I followed the law and I told motor vehicle that I have a disability. And as a result of that disability, they put me on a review schedule to have my license reviewed to see if I'm safe to drive. And because I was homeless one year and didn't get their little request for review and didn't respond, they yanked my license without telling me because I was homeless.
and then get the mail. So I didn't know what was going on until I got stopped for a minor traffic violation, and the cop found out that my license was suspended for medical reasons. Well, that didn't matter. They prosecuted me for criminal charges.
Yeah, they're making it where you have to be wealthy just to travel.
Yeah, so right now I'm actually coming back out of that depths of hell. I'm now in a position where I can get my license back. I just actually filed a motion in court just last week, motion to vacate. A motion to vacate means to dismiss the charge. Because when you may already know this, you may realize this, when you're have a traffic criminal charge, okay, when you're stopped for operating after suspension, which is a criminal charge, at the same time, they can throw traffic violations at you too. Inspection sticker, evidence of insurance, seat belt, okay? Well, those minor violations go to Violations Bureau, which is a inferior subdivision of district court. Your criminal charges go to criminal court. So they divide them and they conquer you. They send you to criminal court for these charges, and your Violations Bureau goes off in this direction, okay? Well, I got all 7 criminal charges dismissed, but the civil charges defaulted against me because I didn't fight them. But I got all of these charges dismissed, which were the grounds for these charges. But they never dismissed the civil charges. So I have almost $1,500 and court fines and reinstatement fees that they think I'm going to pay to get my license back. So I now have to try and fight the court again and say, hey guys, these criminal charges were dismissed. And so these need to be dismissed because these could not have been brought had those hadn't been brought.
It's almost like the situation we're in, because the landlord thing, and then they charged him for criminal trespassing and disorderly conduct. And, you know, he wasn't disorderly all day until this all started happening. He was provoked.
One of the justifiable defenses in Maine for disorderly conduct is if you're provoked, and the landlord going in my house, that was provoking, and then
the other one is
here in Maine. From what I understand, it's an affirmative defense for disorderly conduct. And so that's one of the questions. That's another question that I have, because there's so many unanswered questions that just make you want to give up.
Well, but, there are, and you have to be somewhere.
Can I raise an affirmative defense?
There's a lot of things you can do. What I would
be an alpha, she was going to say.
Yeah, you really need to be an alpha personality to go after these people, because the harder you stand up for yourself, the harder they're going to fight back, and the more malicious they're going to be, and the more lawless they're going to be. The chief judge of our Maine Supreme Court actually wrote an order and said that the Superior Court had no right to accept my deferred disposition, had no right to accept a guilty plea or enter any order while my appeal was pending, okay? This is what Chief Justice Lee Slothman said about Supreme Court. But, she says, the Supreme Court is going to suspend the Maine Rules of Appellate Procedure to validate the Superior Court's order. I have it in writing. The Maine Supreme Court Chief Judge suspended the Maine Rules of Appellate Procedure so that the void order was now valid.
Well, that just...
That's the basis of my lawsuit against them. That's one of the basis. Is what right does the judge have to suspend the rules to validate a void order that was issued against me while I had an appeal pending? And when the same chief judge who suspended the rules admits that the Superior Court had no right to accept my deferred disposition or offer it to me or accept any kind of plea from me at all while my appeal was pending. But they did. And so the Supreme Court validated it, said it's okay, because we say it's okay. I'm not kidding you. It's bad.
Yeah, I understand.
Okay.
Like you said earlier, it's an emotional thing. There should
very emotional.
It's so bad in this state, there should be a freaking support group for people, like people that lose people in car vehicle wrecks, people that have been mistreated by tenants, because I guarantee you there'd be a lot of people showing up.
Maine Tenants Justice League is me. I did start out with a board of directors, but they've petered off, so my incorporation paperwork is kind of not accurate. The two people on there are no longer around, but anyway, that's part of the reason I kind of started it, is the landlords get away with what they get away with because we are so divided and conquered, and we are so fearful for our life that we won't speak up in public because we know the next day we're going to get an eviction notice and we'll have no safety net. And I've been dealing with that for the last 6 years. I've been fighting them. I've been evicted every year, twice since 2016. Since 2011, I've been evicted every year because I raised my rights and I stood on my rights, okay? So the harder you stand on your rights, the harder they're going to fight you. So if you only know you. Only you know how much you can take and for what reason you can take it. I've done it for the same reason that you're doing it, because I have the blessing of having worked for attorneys most of my adult life. So I have a very unique inside knowledge that most people don't have.
He's thinking about taking up law because of all of this.
It's very, I would strongly suggest.
It's very rewarding to be told that, to go through this and to find the laws and find things where you're like, well, that applies to me. And then it gives you some hope. So.
And when I help tenants, since 2013, I incorporated in June of 2013. And since then, I've assisted, I'd say almost 200 tenants, maybe more. And one of the major things that I tell them is, I don't care if you have an attorney or not. Need to know the law. You need to know the rules of procedure, because legally an attorney does not immunize you from responsibility for your case. Okay, your attorney is just your mouthpiece. He's not you, and there are bar rules. He has rules he has to follow. He's not allowed to enter evidence into the record. He's not allowed to enter facts into the record. Only witnesses can do that, meaning you or your witnesses or the other party's witnesses. If he enters facts into the record, he transforms himself into a witness, and then he has to recuse himself from the case. So you need to know the rules of procedure to know when he's making a mistake. Because if he makes a mistake, it could be a fatal error. And they do it all the time. Sometimes they do it on purpose. If they have a buddy on the other side, or intermingled in the case on the other side that they don't want anybody to know about, they'll throw a case. So you need to know the rules of procedure so that you can check and balance. Okay, so if you know that you have 21 days to answer the motion, okay, all motions, most motions, you will have 21 days to answer. Okay, so if the state files.
Well, they told us we're supposed to get our motions in by the end of the month.
Okay, that's
so. This is where we're at. We got to go the 18th, so we got to get something in there.
Well, what happened was.
You can always ask for an extension of time.
Well, they just gave it to us.
You can always ask for another one. If you have good reason, you can always ask for another one. You can say you sought legal counsel and you're asking for an extension of time so that the legal counsel can adequately review the paperwork before you submit your next pleading. There's always something you can do.
Yeah.
I told Michael, I don't think this is going to be the last time
part of it is also stringing it out for them, doing the same thing, letting them know, you know what, I'm ready. If it takes 2.5 years, 3 years.
That's what you want to do for $100?
Yeah. And eventually they will drop all those charges. Okay.
Yeah, because you're going to wear them out.
Yeah, you're going to wear them out. That's what they plan to do with you.
And so the big reward is when not only we get a judgment against, you know, financial thing would be nice, a financial award, but when, because one of the big things I want to do is I want to go after him for his unfair trade practices, actually, he's going. I mean, they're horrible.
Good for you.
Well, it's funny because we look it up. You know, mobile homes are different. They got to put their
yeah.
money in the account. They've got to give them back their interest. He said his
yeah.
our money was in his safe.
Yeah.
Now, he says, no, I'm not giving you our account number.
Never.
It's not supposed to be in your account.
I said, I have right by law. And see, this is what really scared him was when I was sitting in that lobby and I said, well, and I told him that. And he said, well, I don't have to. I said, well, I don't know if you've ever read this before. And I pulled out a copy, a stack that I had made of chapter 15. You know.
He had it.
you know, what is it? Can you pull up chapter 15?
Of the Consumer Guide?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And it's got some really, really good things in there for that. But here's where I am right now, okay? Because this is why I've been calling and doing so much now is because I tried to do it myself.
Try to get a lawyer.
I tried to do it myself, but I'm terrified. And so I have until, what is it? Well, now, but you've already kind of made,
18.
Yeah.
So
well, she already kind of put me at rest with that, now that I think about it.
Yeah, you can.
Because you can get an extension.
And when you know that you're going to need an extension, it's better to put it in sooner than later, because the sooner you put it in, the more thoughtful the judge is going to know that you are, and the more likely you are going to get it.
All right, okay? You
probably should put it in immediately.
So we go over to the Farmington court and get this paperwork?
No, you can just write up something real quick, you know,
send
with
it to
the proper
court.
Heading. Yeah, with the proper heading. And we'll have to talk about which case we're talking about. But just a one paragraph or something saying, you know, are you the defendant in the case?
Yeah.
Say, defendant has sought legal counsel in this matter and is requesting an extension of time or an enlargement of time for 30 days to allow counsel to review the paperwork. Don't say who the legal counsel is, okay?
What about, can you get one for gathering more evidence?
In your eviction case, it's unlikely that they're going to give it to you because that's closed. That case is technically closed, okay? You've got several issues that are going on that are now parallel, okay? So if you've got a pad of paper and something to write with, there's a list of, there's a to-do list that I would suggest that you write. I've got a pen right here if you need one. But before we do that, I want to ask you about...
Are we still able to go after John and do that contempt thing for him?
The contempt, yes, you can. But there's one thing that is very time-limited that I want to talk with you about. Was he aware that you're disabled?
The landlord?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I told him.
Okay, so he knew that you were disabled. Did he know all along? So... Did you feel at any time that he took advantage of your disability and applied certain pressure against you towards the end there? Because the reason I'm asking is because you have certain rights as a disabled tenant. You have rights under the Fair Housing Act, okay? And it sounds like he may have violated your rights.
I think he took advantage of me knowing that my conditions, the way that he did it, yeah, I think it applies because what I'm seeing is that he knew I was going to get upset about it.
And he provoked you to make you upset so that he would have grounds to have you arrested for disorderly conduct.
Yeah, because he already knew that
okay.
I wasn't no guff taker over that. I've told people over there, had to put them in their places for some of the stuff they've done, and they probably didn't care too much about it. But you know, I tell people, you know,
I'm gonna
you mind your business, I'll mind mine.
Right. The reason I'm asking,
Edward, come on, baby, come on, baby. He's a good boy. If he knows I, he got company. We do.
This is Edward. He's very, very shy, so he'll probably run off into one of the rooms. But the reason I ask that is when you were asking for repairs on your unit, okay, first of all, a landlord is required to make repairs.
And if he retaliates by evicting you, that's an issue.
But if your disability plays into that in some significant way, I don't know what your story is, only you know.
Well, what happened is he asked him verbally for a while and wasn't doing nothing, so Michael got educated by realizing we had to write him.
Write him a letter.
And then he still really didn't do nothing. And then we called the code enforcer, and they talked, him and John, the landlord, talked. It took him a while to get back to us. He didn't come when he said he was going to.
Mm-hmm.
Finally got back, came over, and found more than what he had.
The advantage, yeah, I think he took advantage of it. I think that's why he stretched it out so long.
Okay.
I think that the reason he wouldn't fix it is because he's used to people in there that don't know the law, or that have never had to study it.
So when he didn't do nothing, we held our last month's rent.
And that's what he used against you. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's the problem with the MAINE law. Okay. The law says you have a right to do it. But when you do it, you will lose your home. And the court will allow it to happen. And it will actually perpetuate it. All right. And getting back to what I was saying just a little while ago about MAINE Tenants Justice League and having a support group. One of the reasons the landlords are getting away with this, there's several reasons. One of the reasons is, unbeknownst to most people, lawyers own most of the rental property in the state of Maine. Lawyers do. Through their little agents who are their landlords, okay? And their landlords are digital fuckers. And they're evil and they're malicious, okay? And they're in the pockets of the politicians because they grease their pockets, okay? And when there's any kind of legislation regarding landlord-tenant issues, those landlords or their lawyers are both are in those testimonial homes, barking up a storm. We need this, we need that, we can't afford this, we can't afford that, we got piece-of-shit tenants tearing our properties apart, blah, 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 blah. Okay? Blame it all on us, all right? But none of us are there. Because we're terrified that if we're seen in public speaking out against our current tenant, we're going to lose our home. And that's exactly what happens. That's exactly what happens. And that's why this is happening. Right? So one of our biggest hurdles is finding a very small, strong group of people like the three of us and using our personal constitution, our spiritual constitution, to come together and go into these testimony rooms and really raise a stink.
Yeah.
I've already done it. I've got YouTubes out there all over the place.
Now, how
municipal meetings, town meetings.
How much support are you getting
none.
from the community? Like,
next to none. They love that I'm here, and the ones who benefit from my support appreciate me, but the ones who need my support are not capable of supporting me. That's why they came to me. See, I'm unique, and I have had to accept that. I know more than most.
Yeah, but they can when you want to go into that.
I've gone into court with
will
tenants.
Will they go? Yeah.
They're terrified.
Yeah, it's like once the battle's over for them, it's over for everybody in their mind.
I've gone into court with tenants and actually been threatened with criminal charges.
I would love to see them get into law, and I'd love to see this justice come. I'm blown away by the injustice that this.
I'm
51 years old, and I've never seen anything like this.
Did you know? No, you probably didn't know. In the state of Maine, for the past 6 years, the Maine judicial branch's annual reports show that not one tenant in the state of Maine has ever had a trial by jury.
I saw that.
Not one. And I've demanded a trial by jury for fucking years since 2012. And twice in 2016.
From a tenant. I mean, for a landlord, right?
For eviction. For evictions. And we have a right under the 7th Amendment to have a trial by a jury. And not only the 7th Amendment, but the Maine Supreme Court passed the entered a decision back in 1976, I think it was, and the Supreme Court of the United States entered a decision in 1968 saying that tenants have a right to have a trial by jury before they lose their home. In the state of Maine, okay, this is the law in the state of Maine. First, you have to go through district court, eviction court, like you just did. If you lose, you have a right to ask for a trial by jury. But if the landlord makes an allegation that you owe him rent, even if it's completely frivolous, you have to cough up every penny of that alleged rent and submit it with your appellate paperwork within 7 days of the eviction order if you want a trial by jury. And the Superior Court will most likely deny your demand for a trial by jury.
This is where, if he goes into law, this is where it's really needed. It's needed for the tenants.
Well, see, this is a...
And we get screwed.
It has to be taken back. A group of people have to go back. Like, for instance, if you want something done about... well, if you want something done, for instance, they don't have to give me an attorney.
Correct.
Even if I'm mentally ill, all right? They don't have to get, because they're not seeking jail time. And I'm like, but they're seeking a conviction. What about my reputation? What about my ability to defend myself? So I've ranted about it. I got on my social media and said, has not the state of Maine figured a way to fuck you out of your Sixth Amendment right? And your 14th. What about your,
wild on that
I was
day.
Like, what, and what about your 14th Amendment right? No due
civil
process.
Civil rights have been.
And then if you look at it, when that argument about due process, when it goes to the Superior Court in America, they're starting to support it.
Mm-hmm.
So the rich people here that are getting the people elected there are getting it done. Now, the other reason that I think nobody will stand up with you up here is something I've noticed is there's not really a history of oppression here. I'm from the South, and this shit would never fly. In Texas, you'd have the Black Panthers, you'd have Quantum X, all these, and if it was a Mexican, you'd have poor white people.
You know, we only have 1.3 million people up here in the state of Maine, right? Okay, we have very small people up here, and most of them are ignorant white people. Ignorant, uneducated, backwoods white people who just want to be left alone.
Yeah.
They don't care about the law.
I do, because our civil rights were violated. And you know what? I want to hit this landlord right where his pump wallet hurt him.
You nailed it when you said that they've separated us.
Yeah.
They've separated us. In
divided and conquered.
So that's what needs to be conquered. If this is ever going to win, because, you know, it takes more people, you know.
I'm a good tenant, and where I'm living right now, this park here, is owned by a gentleman who I rented from back in 2007. I created Maine Tenants Justice League in 2013, and he knew. He actually ran into me in eviction court almost every year from 2013 up until the current day. You know, what the hell are you doing here now? Jesus Christ, Bill got involved with another slumlord. You know?
That's what I was. We're right back in the same freaking boat.
I got a 19-gallon water heater, and that's cold. I've looked it up. 19 freaking gallons.
I got 8 minutes to take my shower.
Now check it out. Now check this out.
That is so much bullshit.
Build a chimney, if you don't put that stack higher than the highest point in your house, you're going to have something called reverse. It's like a reverse vacuum,
right,
where it's going to, the smoke's going to come when the pressure's not right outside and inside.
Yeah.
So you always want it sucking it out. Well, when they took all the sinks, underneath the sink, there's a P-trap. And the reason there's a P-trap, like on the ceramic part of your toilet, I used to be a maintenance man,
mm-hmm.
So this is why I was able to. I called the code enforcer. He came by. I only had listed six things.
Mm-hmm.
He denied one of the things, but he added six of his own to it. So the guy had 11 things he was to take care of. All right, but this is the new.
And this is the dude who's got a buddy. This is the buddy issuing 11 against a buddy. Mm-hmm. So they must have been pretty serious. Just a side note, the guy who owns this park is freaking awesome. I don't know what you guys are paying for rent, but the trailer's here. This is one of the oldest. All the other ones are a little, like,
are the rents reasonable? I mean, what are they?
I pay $7.95 here with heat included, and the others are $8.95 with heat included. They're all two bedrooms. The one behind me is three bedrooms, but they just moved in. So
mine's $5.75. But it's a piece of
SHIT. And the other one was only $400.
He takes really good care of these places. The one up on the hill, 21, is open right now. I don't know if it's got anybody looking at it, but that's $8.95 with heat included. He's got everybody on auto delivery. And he comes in, he plows. He's a really good guy.
His pipe's freezing.
We have to make sure that we trickle our faucets during really cold weather, because it's really hard to insulate the bottoms of these things. You know, so we do have a little bit of an issue with that, but we just have to be vigilant and do our part. You know.
And if you're renting a place, if I was a landlord, I think at a point I would probably invest in heat tape or something, you know.
Yeah. Well, I've got some suggestions that I made to him. I found some double ply aluminum insulation. It's called Radiant Barrier. And I suggested lining the inside of the skirt with a radiant barrier to at least keep a lot of the cold breeze out. Mm-hmm. So I suggest maybe experimenting with one or two of the trailers this summer, putting some radiant barrier in and seeing how it works next winter. But
I've got to do some more code searching, looking through code and stuff, because
just beware. The more you learn and apply, the more resistance you're going to experience from those in power. Okay? The more you learn, the more resistance you're going to experience, because as I was saying a few minutes ago, these judges and attorneys spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to learn what they know. And here we come.
Nobodies.
Walking in. Piece of shit, nobody, disabled people, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, we're basically stumped.
I hate that. They're basically so pissed.
Them. Coming in and doing as good a job, if not better, than some of these attorneys do. Mm-hmm. My work is pristine, okay? They cannot dismiss my paperwork on the merits, because I do fucking lots of paperwork, because I used to work for attorneys. I used to do this for a living. This is what I did. So
you know how to write memorandums.
Oh, hell yeah.
I don't. Not yet. I'm learning, though.
I filed a writ for petition of certiorari with the Supreme Court of the United States. You know, I've already gone to the Supreme Court.
Well, we know how to write, well, and we can set for time.
This is why I appreciate what you're doing, because what you're doing, like, since you do know that type of stuff, you're keeping me from walking in there looking like a dumbass.
And I would strongly suggest, I don't know what your financial situation is, but I would strongly suggest that you print off a full copy of civil procedure, criminal procedure, and appellate procedure. And keep them handy, because you're going to want to bring them into the courtroom with you.
I had to refer to them.
That's why I've got my tabs.
Yeah, okay. Well, you want to know the last time.
I'll take care of that problem tomorrow.
The argument that happened last time we were in court. First of all, I put my attorney on blast in front of everybody. I did it just enough.
Take a look at my little library.
I kind of hide it off in the corners of the
These are all cases.
Now you're getting to see what our place is going to look like.
Title 14, which is for civil procedure and eviction.
Okay.
Title 14, you also want to print a copy of it. Because rules of civil procedure are based on Title 14 of the main statutes. Okay.
You need to write them down. It's very
complex.
But this is what I attempted to try to do. I don't know if I was getting the format right or not. And I've noticed another thing that is other cases. I've already got all that.
The pellet?
I've already got it all, like, downloaded.
The pellet one?
No, but I've got that written down in my notes on that to look up.
And 14?
Title 14, main revised statutes.
Yeah, all that, anything, yeah. I've got it all written down in there as well. If you look through there, you'll probably find some.
This is excellent. What I do, like, when I have to file a new type of form or motion that I've never filed before, I go out to Google and I'll put in quotation marks, double quotation marks, the type of document that I'm looking for, petition for writ of certiorari. And I will download one of the documents from somebody's website and make sure it's a reputable law firm. Mm-hmm. I usually stick with...
That's how I did that. I didn't download it because I'm not that computer savvy, but I looked at it. And if you've noticed, I do a lot by writing because I'm not computer savvy enough to download.
Do you know somebody who can type for you? Because it's highly advisable that you have everything typewritten as much as you can.
I took typing in high school and I can do it, but it takes me time to build my speed back up because it's not something I enjoy.
If this legal battle is something that you're going to expect to take on for the next several years, and I mean, I've been fighting for 6 years, and I'm not done yet. I would suggest you.
Do you think it's going to take us that long?
It depends on what you're going to take on. You've got several parallel issues going on. Okay, if you want to make life difficult for your landlord, mm-hmm. you can file a human rights complaint against him.
Oh, yes.
Okay, and get him mixed up in a human rights issue.
Yeah.
You can get him for a fair housing complaint. You can do both at the same time. You can do a human rights with Maine Human Rights Commission. You can do fair housing rights with the United States Department of Justice.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. So you can also file a disability complaint against him.
And so the Maine would handle the unfair trade practices?
Unfair trade practices is a civil lawsuit that you need to file against him in court. Okay, that's a private action. But when you file an unfair trade practices claim against him, the court is required to send a copy of that to the Attorney General's office, and the Attorney General's office is required to get involved. Okay? My lawsuit against the judges...
Maybe it's good.
The Attorney General is now involved. Because the federal court got them involved.
Made them do something.
The
Isn't that
court,
sad that you, yeah.
I've had to go to, I'm at the First Circuit Court of Appeals. That's how high up I am. I'm one step below SCOTUS.
Yeah, I just don't understand the thinking up here. It's like these guys,
it's
these
disgusting.
People, these people want to stand around slapping everybody's asses, and then when you get in there, and then they expect everybody to slap theirs, and then they're all offended that you're you know, standing up for yourself. It's just sickening.
It's really...
You know how I got the judge to agree to let me do motions? I went in there and he told me, I am not letting you do motions. He didn't he say that? He said, I am not hearing any more motions.
We didn't submit them.
We're going to jury, right? And what I did is I argued under the procedures.
Mm-hmm.
I said, 45?
Mm-hmm.
It said that... Yeah.
I still have to review. I still have to look at
it. Oh, I'll have to do it for the rest of my life.
Oh, yeah. Even attorneys still.
That's why I did what you said.
Time.
Yeah, you got to have that on hand all
yeah.
the time.
Yeah.
At your court so you can write it down, right? Because.
You know, 45 subpoenas, really.
Let me
subpoena
see.
Rule?
What was it? Let me see. Is it 45 or 48?
Or 54.
I have it written down.
Well, it says it gives you 3 more days.
It deals with time. It's
time.
Under time, so.
Could it be Rule 5, or is it in the middle? There's an index of rules in the very front there. If you go to the very front, there's an index of rules.
I wrote it down right here.
So.
Rule 6.
45.
So rule 45.
No, actually, I may have it in the wrong one. It's under the Maine Rules Unified Criminal Procedure.
Oh, criminal procedure. Okay, that's different. Let me grab that. See, civil procedure and criminal procedure are different. Civil procedure applies to every kind of court case ever filed. Criminal procedure are special rules applied to just criminal cases, which replace civil procedure rules, those numbers, okay? So, like, criminal procedure title 1, it gives you the scope, procedure, et cetera.
Title 2, Title 3 is the Rule 3 is the complaint. So criminal procedure.
I messed up and started studying this for my criminal case and then realized.
They both apply though. Okay. These only apply to these special circumstances that are expressed in here. Anything that's not expressed in here comes from there. Appellate procedure applies to every case. Okay, the rules of appellate procedure applies to both criminal and
civil. Is that like at a higher level in the state?
Right.
A judicial?
It's a completely different court.
Okay, so it's the Superior Court of Maine.
All right. Well, yes. In your case, at this point, yes, that would be the Superior Court because right now you're in District Court. District Court has original jurisdiction over what you're going through right now. So your appeal would go to Superior Court. If you lost in Superior Court, you could appeal that loss to the Supreme Court in Maine. If you lose that appeal, then you're dead unless a federal rule was broken by the court in that process. Then you have to file a new lawsuit against the court in federal court.
Why isn't this considered malice prosecution?
It is, but you have to prove it. That's
for $100.
That's the problem, is you have to.
Taking it, being willing to spend the money on a jury, but not being willing to spend the money on a.
Yeah.
What it says is that, I told him that I had under this.
And you know, I mean, I have to be careful how much I offer, but I would be more than willing to cut these off for you while you're here tonight. I can do it. I've got two printers online right now.
Yeah, but that's,
offer, so.
I don't have a mind to pay for the paper right now.
If you would let me bring you some paper.
You can do it later. I have plenty of paper. You can do it later. You really need to have these rules. And I have plenty of paper. I have plenty of ink. But I know that you have a problem with getting access to these things. And you really need to start studying them. So
doing it all on my computer, having to scroll through. And this would be...
You can write notes.
Yeah, and highlight and mark it like you could.
Yep, so let me do that, okay?
What I told the judge was...
I'll get some binders. And we'll get a hole punch. I think the old man has one over there tomorrow.
You said you have to be an alpha an alpha personality? So...
Don't let them intimidate you.
Well, I went in there and I'm... Just to show you how I approach stuff, all right? When I went in there, I told him that because I had been informed by mail, which is what this rule says, that I had 3 more days than the date that they had given me. Because they had sent the notice by mail. You know what he told me?
No, he thought he was wrong.
He told me that I only had until a certain date, and that was it, and
the
he wasn't
after,
hearing it anymore.
The day after that court date.
And I told him, you know what, Your Honor, I really believe it's wrong, and so I read the rule to him, I really believe you're wrong, and you know, and he had said, he made a mistake, though. You know what he did? He messed up with me, and he said one thing. I said, no, Your Honor, I really believe you're wrong, and I believe you just even told me that you might be wrong. You just said that. And he did.
You.
And you're
oh,
all,
I'm
you would have thought you were.
I believe I'm 100%.
You just you saw that $1,000 he spent on his education coming out. And you saw those nickels coming out his ears. He was so hot.
I love it.
And so you know what he said. Well, you know, he told me to sit down and he'd show me the law. I said, well, can you show me now? And he was like, no, you know, other people. So I sat down. Well, this is what he sent out to me. I kept it. All right. He sent this out to me.
It's so much fun to put them in their place. It really is.
I'm like, oh, man, Ball. I'm thinking, this is all new to me, right? And I'm thinking, oh, Michael, you got some big kahunas.
Well, I just noticed what she says there. In Latin, I believe it says carpe diem. When you see carpe diem, it means seize the day. But this says carpe scrotum. Which, you know, grab life by the balls. That's a good one for here. I like it. But he sent this back to me. He told me
I'm so glad he
that he come across you, because he, this has been very trying for him. Meant, you know, this, yeah. When I go after him, after John Bouvier in the album,
at the
pain
very,
and suffering.
At the
is,
very least, okay, you're going to get giggles every time your John, your landlord, has to file a paper in court, because he'll have to pay for it. And every time his attorney picks up the phone or picks up a paper or anything, he has to pay for it, okay? So at the very least, you're going to get justice.
See,
just by costing him money.
Yeah.
This is
when I really go after
him
for my
loss,
this
is
where
my that's the only place where the justice is right now.
Yeah.
Okay? It's
yeah.
just stringing them along.
He,
really, because the end result, I need to prepare you, okay? The end result, you will lose. And the reason for that is because the courts are corrupt, for one.
Yeah.
And
you're saying we're not going to get paid?
You might
not
get some money from him. You might be able to, okay? But that's
down the road.
Down
that's
the road
why I want to go after
that.
The city.
Because like, you can get more than just
they cost me my crop that day.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and that's something I don't know if you can argue.
They
now
cost
that,
because they made me
was
homeless.
October, but that was October, and it wasn't legal then. Or were you legal?
I have a
yeah,
card.
She has a card.
Oh.
And
I
she
have
had
a card.
It, no, and everything. And we were going to. We
so
had
there are se- that's why I said there are several parallel things going on, okay?
It cost
but
me my medical card.
That wasn't cheap.
They left me homeless. I had to put them into the storage set because I had, you know,
yeah.
didn't have the money, so I couldn't forward, you know?
And the sequence in which you do things will impact, okay?
You need to write them how
we are. Yeah, there is a sequence in which you need to do things because one thing will affect the next.
John, contempt of court is the one that we should be doing right off.
So I told him that I had 3 more days because it was sent by mail, mm-hmm. and he sent me this, and I knew that I still had 3 more days, right? But I didn't argue that. Well, I wouldn't even get up and argue the same law. All right? I wasn't going to get up and argue the time law because I knew it still applied.
So he tried to come out and say 7.
So, yeah, so you know what I did? I read it. All right? I read it to him, and I said, yeah, he said, did you have a chance to read it when he finally got back to me? And he didn't make me wait a lot. He took a recess, went in the back, did that, sent it to me, right, and came back. And so he said, did you read it? And I'm thinking to myself, okay, he's probably going to expect me to get up there. I said, he already blew that law out. This is what he's given me to read. I said, what can I find in this that I need to question that's going to, and so I dug at it, and this is what I found in it, okay? Right here, he says, it said, but, the, okay, if the motion, anyway, it says that you have to file it at which hearing? All right, let's just read the whole thing. Motion to dismiss. Motions related to joiner of offenses. Motions seeking discovery pursuant to court order under Rule 16, 16A. Motions, press evidence, and other motions to admissibility of evidence shall be served upon the opposing party but not filed with the court at least 7 days before the date set for the disposition conference under Rule 18.
Okay.
If the matter is not resolved at the disposition conference,
mm-hmm.
the motions shall be filed with the court no later than the next court date following the disposition conference.
Okay.
So what I did is I looked at this, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is what I was looking at in my files. I looked at this. And I took that letter and sent it.
Where do you work now?
This is what I do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I have material. I have scoliosis and material in the spine issues. I just woke up paralyzed for the Thanksgiving. Spine material. So I do some software debugging. I do website debugging. I do bug testing on new websites and stuff. Whatever.
So what I did is I asked him what that, I said, well, it's okay. And this is what, it says that all those motions have to be in,
mm-hmm.
all right, at least 7 days before the disposition conference. And if the matter isn't resolved at this person, you have till the motion shall be filed with the court no later than the next court date following the disposition conference. Okay. So I asked him, well, then what's the next court date, Your Honor? Mm-hmm. If following the disposition conference, and that was that day, which was the hearing or motion?
Yeah, the
whatever,
hearing, the third.
Right?
Which was this one. The 31st, the day after.
And I said, well, that would be today. And he said, well, it would seem like it's written that way. All right, but I got him caught right here. I was setting him up, and he didn't even see it coming. All right? I said, so the next day, and he said, well, and the clerk answered for him, said it would be, which was,
maybe
so that the conference was on the 30th, they said it would be on the 1st, right? Or it was
31st.
Because there's 31 days in January. So they said it would be the 31st. So what I did is I whipped this out in my hand real quick, and I said, well, and it does say that I was notified by mail, but I said, did somebody in your office and your clerk's office messed up because they told me I had till the 3rd. They told me I had till the 3rd, and you're telling me now I had till the 31st. So they gave me more days. They gave me 3 more days. They sent it by mail, but I received it by mail, and I still get 3 days. And it says in that law, I didn't argue that, but he basically, because there were people there, he started
stammering.
When I started to go, it would seem that way, and I went, well, then somebody in your office, and that's when he bent, and he gave me like 25 more days, and he was telling me earlier, and there was another gentleman in there that just had a baby or a grandbaby or something. You know, you could tell he had been in the military, clean cut. I looked like somebody in the office knew him that was helping him out with his thing, and when he sat there and watched that, when I was leaving, he was like, you had a good day.
Yep.
And that feels good. You know what I mean? It feels good.
And that's
good.
Why you need, and that's why I'm taking these off of you, because that is, when you walk in there armed with your rules, okay, you're going to be able to challenge that judge respectfully with the rule and say, with all due respect, Your Honor, the rule says, and I did this in district court during an eviction hearing. I walked in. I have a recorder that I use, and this has no metal parts, so it does not set up metal detectors. So I walk in, eviction, and I'm walking up to the witness stand, and I told the court, I said, I'm recording this for note-taking purposes. You can't do that without my permission. Excuse me, I beg to differ. I said, Rule 76HA. Check it out.
It's a public space, right?
Rule 76HA says that nothing in this rule shall prevent any party from recording any hearing provided they don't use the recording without permission from the other party. She's like, let me look at the rule. She had to read the rule 3 times on the bench.
Isn't that amazing?
Okay, now let me finish the story. 9 months later, they changed the rule. The current rule now, they expressly forbid you from recording your hearing without express permission by the judge.
See, all they do is when you
challenge
find,
them,
when you find
they
a,
change
them. Challenge them, then
when
they
you,
change
when,
it.
When,
yes, they
when
will.
You find something that benefits you, they go back and change
they
it
will.
To benefit themselves.
They will. That's exactly what they did. So I don't know what this 76HA says. But the current 76H says you cannot record your hearing without express permission. And if the bailiff or any court officer catches you recording or using your phone, they'll take it away from you and you might not get it back.
I was wondering about that because I told Mike I like to turn that thing down and have no one call me and record this whole thing.
So my suggestion is to get a recording device that has a really nice microphone on it that has no metal parts so that you can walk it into the courtroom without being noticed. What I usually do is I'll start it up before I leave home or before I get out of the car or something, and I take a piece of duct tape and I tape it on my chest because I know it won't set off the metal detector.
That's a way to still be able to have recording in case they turn off their recorders.
They can't turn them off if they do manipulate them. down. I have a cousin who was in a case, and he asked for a transcript of the hearing because he got a favorable decision. Well, he recorded the hearing. The recording that he got from the court and his recording did not match because the recording he got from the court had the favorable part of the judgment.
So can you get in trouble for doing that, though?
It's First Amendment.
Exactly, you're
right.
First
Amendment, public hearing.
Yeah, that's the thing. I saw a guy today.
Public.
Yeah.
Now, here's another. In your little list, write a case down.
Write a case.
Regarding recording. It's 2011. Glick, G-L-I-K.
What is it?
Glick, G-L-I-K, versus Cunniff, C-U-N-N-I-F-F-E, and it's the First Circuit Court of Appeals, 2011.
Much better.
And this one, basically the gist of this one is Glick, Simon Glick, was a pedestrian walking through Boston Common, and he watched Officer Cunniff and his other officers assaulting somebody in Boston Common. And so Simon Glick started recording the officers on his cell phone. And the officers noticed Simon Glick recording them and told him to turn off his phone, and Glick said no. And they arrested him for violation of the wiretapping statute. Okay? And they eventually dismissed the charges against Simon Glick for wiretapping because he waived his rights. Well, Simon then turned around and sued them for violating his civil rights, for taking his phone away and First Amendment rights and 14th Amendment rights. And he won because the officers were performing a public duty as public servants in public view. And as such, they are required to submit, to surrender to video and audio recordings without objection. And that applies to police officers, judges, politicians, municipal leaders, everybody who's a public servant.
So even if they, even if I got caught playing with their recording,
Matter of fact, when you go out to YouTube, I recorded the hearing where they dismissed 6 and 7 charges. I told them ahead of time that I was going to video record my trial. So I brought my laptop in and I set up my video recorder as soon as I got into the courtroom. Well, we were not officially on the record at that time, but I started my recorder anyway without telling them. 45 to almost 55 minutes or so of recording. And I left the courtroom for about 5 minutes to go outside and have a cigarette. And they threatened to prosecute me in violation of the recording statute in Maine because I left the room. In the state of Maine, one party law. If you record somebody else, you're required to be present. Just be present at the time of the recording, okay? So if I took my recorder and started it up right now and left it here and got into your car and went to the store, I would be violating your rights because I would be recording the private conversation while I was not here, okay? But I can start this up right now and record you without telling you. And that's lawful. And that's also lawful against every public servant because you're paying your salary.
So
they were pissed at me because I left the courtroom for 5 minutes while I was recording and I'm talking about it. And I put it on YouTube.
So
when they found it on YouTube, my court-appointed attorney says, you know, you really shouldn't have done that. You know, they really pushed against us. Go for it. I was in a public hearing. What are they going to do? That was an open court hearing.
I told him I was recording. I gave him full warning. Video recorder was right there. My laptop was open up. The webcam was right there.
They never did nothing about it.
They just threatened me. They like to threaten people.
Yeah, that way they, because you know what? Most people don't do that. But lawyers are trained, and people like that are trained not to care about.
This is a fascinating case. That's a fascinating case. And actually, if you go up to Google Scholar.
Google Scholar,
yeah, is Google's legal research page. And they have a very nice selection of current and archived old historical
cases.
And you actually find me up there. I'm on Google Scholar.
You know, I've noticed that in a lot of the argument cases that I didn't realize till I began doing trials how relevant the cases that have already been tried. It's like here in the district, if I had one here that had already been in that district and had already been something relevant like to this,
mm-hmm.
it would play into this one. And then when you go above them to the next, like the state level, I didn't realize till I started watching how relevant that is, because it's like it's already been decided in the way they decided.
And that's what thank you for bringing that up, because from this point forward, every time you get a court order or any kind of paper from the opposing party, pay very close attention to the laws they mention, the rules they mention, and the prior decisions that they quote, okay? And go out and print off those prior decisions that they quote. Print them off and take and handwrite notes about them and use those decisions in your favor, okay? And while you're reading the decisions that they quoted, use the decisions within that decision to support your case. Okay.
Like something like the Miranda he was doing then.
Everything that they file, look at it as a learning tool, as a teaching tool, as more information to support your case, because you want to do two things. First, you want to cite your case. But the second thing you want to do just as significantly is you want to play devil's advocate for yourself. You want to have a second mindset and say, okay, if I file this motion, what will he do? Okay. What claim will he make?
That's all
himself?
I sit around doing.
Okay.
That's
okay, so if he's going to make this defense, then how can I thwart that defense before he makes it? I bring it up in my motion. Okay. So you try to discredit their presumed defenses before they can bring them up. Or you prepare yourself knowing that that's what they're going to do, so you can respond with the script. Because one of the things that my friends always told me, she goes, Gina, these attorneys have several cases that they're trying to juggle. They're not focusing on any one case. They're not giving their 100% to any one of these cases. You are. You have your case only. And you put your mind to that case and you be ready on the fly. Play devil's advocate. Think outside the box what they might say. Read the rules, but especially stick to the rules, and if at all possible, don't ever violate them. The most minuscule violation can be a fatal error. Okay, so watch your timelines, make sure you abide by dates, make sure you ask for extensions of time if you need them, continuances.
The reason that I think I have a natural knack for this is I lived out at the ranch. I was a ward of the state of Texas at the age of 12 and a half. And I wound up out at a place called the first boys ranch ever established here in America. It was an 11,000-acre ranch built on an old ghost town. It was a county seat. And we had corporal punishment. So I've learned how to deal with what you need to do, you know, what's this man going to ask you? You better, you know, so how to keep from getting a belt put across. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, and I believe that it was because of that. It's part of my post-traumatic stress disorder. But
yeah, I dealt with a father who, I was never right. And he never said yes. So I had to learn you know, if I ask you for this in this way, what would you say? Okay, so you're going to have to ask me for this in this way, in a way that I'm not asking, so he thinks it's his idea, you know. That's
what I did with the lawyer.
Yeah.
I mean, with the judge.
Exactly.
When I said, oh, well, this is your law. Well, then your court didn't do what it's supposed to do because I got a piece of paper that doesn't match that date, you know.
And another thing that's very important to remember about judges, they think they have power, but they don't have any more power than you give them. You don't have to agree to anything, okay? They are a mediator. They're a referee only. They can only order what you agree to, okay? They can't force you to agree to anything.
What about the jury? They want. He said we're coming back on the 18th. It's. Well, that's the other thing. See, his rule that he gave me says that I have till that. Now the new letter they sent me, they didn't say it's a jury selection. What they said is that it's another one of those. They're starting over with the what condition or what's it called, a condition or. Something can the first what he said in the paper was
on condition that you I gave it back to him.
He said that the last date you have to turn in your motions is that well he told me I had till the end of the month to turn my motions in.
Mm-hmm.
He said it was in his discretion, but when I got the letter. I noticed that it said exactly what in his. They said it back. And, you know, it would have been a. I can show you better than I can tell you.
So these criminal charges were a direct result of the landlord in contempt of the eviction judgment. With the purpose of provoking you into that behavior so that he could file these charges against you. Okay. There is a way that you can stop these criminal charges dead in their tracks for several months. And that is by filing the motion for contempt in district court against your landlord and then filing a motion for a stay in the criminal case.
That's what I was
and
wanted.
A stay would be based
okay.
on
yeah.
your motion for contempt because the landlord's behaviors were precipitating factors in his behavior, in his reaction. His reaction was secondary to the landlord's contempt of the court order. And you have proof that he contempted the court order by the IOU that he gave you, which I presume you have
yeah,
the original.
Yeah, we still have it.
Okay,
yeah.
That's perfect because you need to show that as evidence that he violated the court order, which was the precipitating factor in his reaction, in addition to the physical intimidation that he showed against them.
Mm-hmm.
Not only him personally, but two big old goons, and then calling the police department,
three or four.
However many there were,
yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Two truckloads of guys.
So, if you file for a motion for contempt against him in the eviction, with those facts, then you would want to file a motion for a stay in the criminal case pending the outcome of the contempt charge because it was the landlord's action which was the first action.
Mm-hmm.
His contempt of that.
Michael's in there trying to tell him this, and the judge looks down at the DA,
well,
and the DA says,
well,
it's a civil.
You know why I messed up? One of the things is. I let them know that I silence may have gotten it dismissed. A little more silence, being a little more ignorant, you know.
And in a way, you have to play stupid with these people, okay? You have to know what you're doing, but you have to do it in a way that they don't know what you're doing. You have to make it look like you just kind of stumbled upon this.
I heard this.
Okay.
I heard this.
Because the smarter you look, the harder they're going to come down on you.
There was a, yeah, and so there was a guy using that, and what he was saying was, it's called objection, point of clarity. of clarification. Mm-hmm. And he kept using that. And he kept asking the judge. And when the judge would try to, he was like, well, I'm trying to, you know, clarify this. And I want to make sure, is that a yes? And he, as he was going through these questions. And
Probably irritating the hell out of the judge.
But it was working because he was stretching it out. And the judge wasn't able to force him to get a jury.
That's exactly it. And another thing. This is a legal term. And it's very tricky. The word understand. Okay. In everyday language, it means basically that you comprehend what's being said. Okay? In legal jargon, it means you stand under the jurisdiction and last statement of the person who just asked you, do you understand? Yes, I understand. Okay, that means you agree. So if the judge says, do you understand these charges?
Yeah.
Say, no, I don't understand the charges.
Because there's an you have a right to explanation, or whatever it's called, right?
I hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
I hear the charges that you're reading off to me, but I don't understand how I can be brought into court on these two charges when the precipitating factor was this landlord's contempt of the court order that caused me to react that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're trying to, you know.
I tried doing that, but like I told you, if you don't file this paperwork, they'll ignore you. It's just like the landlord. I didn't write a letter, he ignored me. If I don't put in the paperwork, they're going to ignore me.
Contempt of court is the first thing we need to do.
One of the fears that I'm dealing with right now, okay, this is the attitude that I'm dealing with, and this is the fear with what I'm thinking I'm going to face with the judge, is when I go back in there, he's going to try to force it to jury, to me picking a jury.
I faced jury selection 6 times.
Okay. Well,
before I actually had to choose.
I think what he's going to do is try to deny me to have any motions. And like you said, I can ask for an extension, but my argument to that is when he told me he couldn't hear any more motions, but he gave me more time and he said till the end of the month, and then I got this letter in the mail that says this on it, and it says that I'm going to, what's that say right there? Disposition.
Dispositional conference.
Okay, which is right here. If he says that, well, I already gave you till the end of the month, he'll tell you, but this letter right here, Your Honor, says that I have, and you last time you I was here, you gave me this. See what I'm saying?
Okay.
And so
okay.
If he tries to deny me any more time,
I gotcha, okay.
I can say, well, you know, I don't have to pick them today.
And you can even get this delayed by filing the motion for contempt against the landlord.
At this day.
And then filing the motion for
so
stay.
You think that's the
I think that would be your best option, because all of this is the result of the landlord violating the judgment and not giving that $1,000.
So then, what do we prepare for? What do we prepare for that case, the contempt of court, to prove that what he did, right?
You would have to provide facts and evidence to show that he did not give you the $1,000, and it's very easy to show that.
It's called a stay. We're in. It's like a postponement.
Do you have that IOU with you?
It may be in with the receipts from the. I need to go through and find my lease that I had with them.
Mm-hmm.
But that really is.
That's
a, not. But that
well,
really is
yeah,
irrelevant
but
right now because
it is
the
when
court
it is
judge,
when, it is when the judge asks you to see it or somebody asks you to see it. You don't want to be looking. You don't want to not have.
Well, I mean, it's nice
evidence.
To have.
At some point, it will be relevant. But at this point, the most relevant thing
is our paperwork from the court. I mean, it all hinges on that.
Is the judgment for eviction and the landlord's IOU.
Did we ever cash any of the checks?
No.
But you have one of them. Mm-hmm. And I have the other one at the house that I put up somewhere.
And you never cashed the checks?
No. Never cashed the checks.
Okay, that's good.
Because I didn't want it to look like, oh, I was just trying to mess the landlord over. I didn't do it for money. I did it because of my, you know, warranty of habitability.
And the check was like $100?
Yeah, this one was for the $100.
And this is what he had it in. He had it in this envelope, right?
For $100.
He had it in here with a check for $100.
I need to make another
look,
copy of that.
And check it out,
it's getting tattered and torn.
Look at this. He had it sealed, right? He had it sealed in this.
In a Ziploc baggie.
And when he came up, he hands me this. As I'm taking it, he reaches in my hand and jerks the keys out of my hand.
I like to make a copy of both of them at the same time.
I'm going to scan them right now.
Isn't that something?
That is blatant contempt.
Yeah.
That is blatant contempt.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If I was you.
Okay.
And that's the best case scenario I can give you. If I were in your shoes, the first thing I would do is I would write up a very short, easy motion for contempt. Read the rules of procedure first on contempt, okay? And the thing about the rules of procedure, quote the rule.
Yeah, that's why he gave them those maps. Right.
It's very, very important to quote
rules. Oh, I numbered it and
quote
everything.
Quote laws
yeah.
and quote judges' decisions in other cases, okay?
So
very
that it's on
little.
The, so that it's on the tapes, or?
No. What I mean is reiterate what you read, okay? So very little of your own opinion will
yeah.
be in your paperwork.
Just facts.
Most of your paperwork will be facts, mm-hmm. evidence, law,
yeah.
procedure, and precedent.
So you
other
really,
cases.
So you really thought that motion was pretty well written?
Yeah.
Because I tried to leave out all opinion in it. And I've got a lot more law that I want to add into it, and I've even got cases that I've looked up.
Do you have an email address that I can send you some templates? Because I can send you samples of stuff that I've already written.
Yeah. I do.
Okay, so why don't you leave me your email address before you go? And
oh, God, you're
stuff.
So good to us, Lord. Thank you.
This is awesome.
Can I use your restroom?
Certainly. That way, and just on the other side of the wash and dry.
I've had just enough Pepsi, enough water to make me float.
I need to find that $300 one. He never gave me back the deposit interest that he got.
Yeah,
I mean,
these landlords,
so
they love
different.
To take advantage.
Wait, before I say anything, Pine Tree had us file a thing for our, to get our deposit back.
Mm-hmm.
So then you know what he did?
What?
He sent us a $300, our security deposit was $400.
Mm-hmm.
He sent us a $300 check and considered that $100 to be the four. He never gave us a full $400 back.
And he didn't submit any kind of explanation as to
no.
why he was only giving you
$300? Nope. Nothing.
Okay.
The other thing that happened was my last attorney never, like, according to the way I've seen the law or the way I've been reading it, he has to, before he can not be my attorney,
he has to withdraw.
And he never did that. And I have proof that when I was sitting in Pine Tree Legal, one of the attorneys there, she called him and asked him if he still wanted to take this on. And he said yes in front of her on a conference call.
Yeah. It is. It's pretty disgusting how corrupt our...
Do you think that even though it's this nasty, that you think I'm still going to have to take it to the Supreme Court here in this state?
It depends on how you play your cards, okay? And like I said to you on the phone, I have a reputation in Maine. If you mention my name or Maine Tenants Justice League, their attitude towards you will shift in a negative direction, and you'll get next to nowhere with them. But if you play stupid, okay, play dumb, use the knowledge that you have in a way that they think you just kind of stumbled upon it, you'll do much better. Okay, I'll help you behind the scenes.
So the more I scare them, the harder they're going to work.
Yes.
And the less, the more country dumb is what I call it is. Really, Your Honor?
Yeah.
I didn't know. Can you explain this to me?
Yeah.
You know?
Don't ever use the word sovereign, okay? Don't ever bring up any of those arguments. I studied all that stuff for a long time, and I started using
more.
Those arguments. Oh, God, no, backfired big time.
See, this is also how it would get changed here. You know, like what you're doing, you're educating people. And that's why.
That's what they're scared of.
That's right.
That's exactly what they're afraid of.
Knowledge is power.
I have successfully delayed or completely stopped more than 2 dozen evictions just by educating the tenants in a few days.
Do you keep deep? So you pretty much do what you do with us, like you
with
record
everybody.
Everything, and
yeah.
So you've got all the history of what you've been doing.
Yeah.
You know, one day. You might get some recognition. recognition, yeah, instead of recognition. The whole nation might, you know, that'd be good.
Well, I want people, and I started Maine Tenants Justice League not just for tenants. My purpose was to educate landlords about their responsibilities to their tenants. One of the things that I tell tenants, I didn't tell you today, but I usually tell all tenants when I first talk to them, first and foremost, you're going to lose the eviction, okay? You need to understand that. And the reason I didn't say it to you is because you've already lost the eviction, so it's irrelevant. Had you come to me while you were still in your home fighting the eviction, I would have said you're going to lose. One way or another, eventually you will lose. And the reason is because you don't legally own that trailer. And he has no legal responsibility or obligation to allow you to live there. Okay? So even if you won on the affirmative defense, 30 days later, he can evict you for no cause. Okay? Unless you've got some kind of...
And that's what I was trying to make him have to do.
But they don't like to do that. Yeah. Well, he's gotten himself mixed up in a big old mess, which is just going to mushroom on him. Okay?
What do you think?
Just starting to mushroom.
You think his attorney has made him aware of what...
His attorney has probably said, oh, this will go away, and it'll go away eventually. It'll go, just hang in, it'll go away. Okay? Now, getting back to what was I just saying, bring me back to what I was
telling
you off track. I know, I hate that when that happens. Oh, all tenants lose because they don't own the property, okay? Eviction court wants to know one thing and one thing only. Who has the legal right to possess the property? And if you don't pay your rent,
they don't care. We would have been better to pay our rent,
Yeah. Or at least to hold on to it and bring it with you to the courthouse, okay? That's what I tell tenants now is, if you can hold on to it, a lot of tenants can't. If you can afford to hold on to it, if you want to withhold your rent, by all means, the law gives you that right. But you need to take care of yourself and protect yourself by saving that money. Give it to somebody trustworthy who will hold on to it for you so that you don't spend it. You don't want to give it to the landlord, okay? But you want to have it available because when he files an eviction against you for non-payment of rent, you want to bring that cash with you to the courtroom and say, I've got your rent as soon as you fix my apartment. Do this, 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 and this. I'll give you your rent when that gets fixed. Hey, Judge, I've got the rent right here, but he's got these things that he needs to fix, and he won't fix them.
You think I can get him...
That's how you win an eviction, but you only win temporarily. Okay?
Because now they want you
now
out.
Now they're really pissed.
They want you out. They're not going to renew your lease.
Really pissed.
Can I call the code enforcer back and ask him to go back?
You don't have legal standing anymore.
Really?
You're now out of the building, and you no longer have legal standing.
But what about the code enforcer's obligation to enforce?
You can call and follow up on issues that you complained about as a concerned citizen because you raised the issue and you would like a status report on the repairs that were required to be made. Okay? And you certainly have that right because you're a concerned citizen.
Wouldn't
that
be interesting to see
how
many were done and how many weren't by now?
And that is all public record. Okay, if you know anything about freedom of information, you have a right to that information. And the law has now allowed for emails to be legal transmission methods. So you can email the town code enforcement and say, please send me all data regarding this property from this date to this date under the Freedom of Information Act. And they have to do it. They have 20 days. And if they don't want to do it, they have 5 days to tell you. So if you ask them on the 1st and they already know that they don't want to give it to you, they have until the 6th to say no. And then you have to force them to do it.
How do you do that?
Sue them. I've done that too. Like I said, it's been a fucking mess.
So you'll probably be doing this for
a long time.
Have you won any money out of all this, doing all this?
Believe it or not, I got CMP, Central Maine Power Company, to pay pay me $3,100 for breach of contract. That's a fucked up story. I actually, they thought they had me, okay? They sent me a settlement agreement and non-disclosure agreement, and it had certain terms in it that I didn't like. So I changed them. I changed the contract that they sent to me to sign. They said, if you sign this contract, we'll send you $3,100 in settlement. Okay, so I got the contract and I didn't like it. So I changed it and I sent it back to them after I signed it. They never took the time to read it. They signed it. They sent me my $3,100. Okay, the changes I made said that the $3,100 they were sending me was a partial payment. And that I did not release them from any liability, and I did not agree to any confidentiality, okay? And then I filed a lawsuit against them after they paid me. And they thought I was bullshitting, and they thought they had the court in their back pocket. So they never answered my complaint. So I have now a $50,000 default judgment pending against the Center Maine Power Company that I now have to fight this Maine Superior Court to get enforced.
Well, that, you're more than break even for the rest of your life paying them, right?
But the funny thing is, Central Maine Power paid their attorney $273 an hour to fight me. And he lost.
Mm-hmm.
And he's pissed. But the courts and the lawyers are in bed together.
Yeah,
okay?
They're all
so
attached
the
court,
well, I'm
to the
going
assholes.
After John Bouvier for...
The court protected CMP, and CMP is like, oh, please, oh, please, oh, please, oh, please, 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 oh, please.
Yeah.
And the court's like, okay, we'll take care of it.
Yeah, they're all attached to the assholes, and you know what? That's a lot of fucking assholes. That's
yeah.
a big asshole party
yeah.
right there.
Yeah, so they hate it when people... know what they know. They hate it even more when you apply it as well as, if not better, as they do.
If they wanted us to do good, and this is just my personal theory, all right? If they wanted us to do well in court, or I should say it like that, well, not good, because that's not proper English. But they wanted us to do well in being as American citizens, being able to defend ourselves and to be able to know the law. And they would probably do a lot more in our education system than what they're doing. They want us to be stupid. They want us like a bunch of little lambs. You know what? I was sitting there watching a guy, and I was sitting there going, these fucking idiots, man. The guy went up there, and he's facing a trial for dealing heroin. And they asked him, do you want a jury or judge? And he went, I don't see no time to waste the courts anymore. You know, the court's time and money. And I was thinking... Man, come outside. I'm going to hit you in the head with this. You know, you're just making it easy. Don't waste your time. Don't you realize they're fucking wasting your time? It don't matter if you're guilty or not. You know?
Yeah.
The whole point is to not look guilty.
Yeah. And the more you sit in the courtroom, the more disgusted you're going to be, because that's what you're going to see over and over and over and over and over and over and over. Just... When they see a black robe, they immediately become intimidated. Yes, Your Honor, no, Your Honor, you know. Well, me...
Instead of an equal, we should feel in this country. We're all equal. That's how we should feel.
In 2014, when they evicted me in 2014, I had a bee in my bonnet, and my bee was really pissed. Because the judge who was trying to evict me had no business being on that judge, on that stand. She had a conflict of interest, which I'll get into later. She knew it, I knew it, everybody knew it. And so I called by her first name. When she called me, I said, Valerie, you have a conflict of interest. Oh boy. She tossed her papers up and she sat back in her chair. She says, Miss GinA, because I've changed my name, I dropped my last name, I just GinA now. Miss GinA, I did not change my name. You will not call me by my first name. I said, excuse me, but Valerie, we have a conflict of interest. You should not be sitting there. You know. Miss GinA, if you call me by my first name again, you will be held in contempt of court. Is that understood? Yes.
Objection, Your Honor.
Yes.
Objection, Your Honor. I gotta get it right.
when they threaten you with contempt of court, shut your mouth.
Yeah, well, that's when I saw the guy. He said that when they do that, he says he was real careful. What he did was he said, if you say jurisdiction one more time, I'm gonna have you held in contempt. And he goes, so let me get this. He goes, objection, point of clarity, Your Honor. So what you're telling me is that I can't talk about the subject anymore, and he let him and he was like, I don't know. He was getting under that. He was getting
under his
skin. He's a tick under the saddle.
Yeah, yeah. I suggest that anybody who goes into the courtroom views the judge as a 2-year as a second grader. Okay, you need to paint the picture for them. You need to tell them what the law is, what the law says, how to apply the law, but you have to do it in a very gentle way. You have to kind of lead them to it.
Yeah.
So that they
play country dumb.
Country dumb. So they know what you want them to do. They can only do what you agree to.
Yeah.
And it's your responsibility to bring up and support 6 elements. And I'll write those down for you because they're really, really important. My friend taught me this, and it's, oh my God, it saved my life. You have to raise and prove the facts, the evidence, the law. You have to cite what laws are relevant, the procedure, which is here. Okay, there's a difference between the laws and procedures. The laws are Maine revised statutes, okay, and the procedures is Maine rules of civil procedure or Maine rules of criminal procedure, okay, or Maine rules of appellate procedure, okay.
What does appellate mean?
Appellate.
What does the word mean?
To appeal, to object.
Okay, so it's
to ask for a higher court to review the facts and the decisions in that case. So you've got facts, evidence, law, procedure, then you've got liability. Who's liable? And damages. What are your damages, okay? If you can show all 5 of these, but you cannot show damages, you'll lose.
Okay. We're going to show our put us out of their home. The mental anguish has been...
That's
now, is that in the criminal or civil?
Either or.
Civil. The criminal is different because you're defending yourself.
That's right.
Okay.
This is a burden of proof that I have.
Right.
Okay.
The criminal is dependent upon the civil. If you can take action with the civil by turning the tables on him and filing a motion for contempt against him, he'll have to defend that motion for contempt. He'll have to explain to the court
why he did
what he did. And you have video evidence to show what he did, to show that he used the court, the police against you, and not even the proper police, the local police, not the county police, okay? So he's going to have to explain to the court why he did what he did, which provoked you to react the way that you did, which resulted in him charging you with criminal charges because you were simply standing on your rights under that judgment. That's all you were doing. You were standing on your rights under that judgment, and he bullied you with the law.
And literally with the police.
Yeah, with the police. He used the police to bully you. And so that's why I would suggest you filing a motion for contempt immediately, bring up those issues, so that you can use that as a springboard to get these criminal charges either stalled.
So we need that
or
and stay
dismissed.
The 2 things we need to do Monday is that and stay.
I have procrastinated. And there's something else I wanted to be honest with you about when I came over here. Right? I have procrastinated because this drove me into it.
It's overwhelming
this,
when you
well,
don't
this,
know what to do.
This has made me, I'm going to start attending AA.
Good for you.
Because it's made me, I used to be able to drink and it wasn't a problem. And now I start to look at stuff. I start to study it, and if I'm happy, it'll keep me up for a while. You know, the bipolar.
Mm-hmm.
And but then when I get discouraged and I think start thinking I'm gonna lose, it just I've been going to that, so that's the commitment I'm willing to make, is that I'm gonna take the steps to make sure I can stay focused on it.
I would support you to absolutely stay with alcohol. When you feel anxious, if you've got access to weed, I have a caregiver who's freaking awesome. Her prices are really fantastic. I can hook you up with somebody to provide you with a supply if you need. But I use weed to keep me stable. I have diagnosed with bipolar. And I've been on almost every medication known for bipolar, except for really heavy duty stuff. But I've been off medication since 2006. And I only use marijuana to maintain my stability. And what I've come to realize for myself, for bipolar, first we realize that it's extreme highs and extreme lows. For myself and people who I've talked with who relate to me, it's an abundance of creative energy that I have no physical outlet for. My brain is always in overdrive. I have so many creative thoughts running through my head. All these things I want to do. All these things I want to do, okay? I've got a 20 by 10 by 7 greenhouse sitting right there in my corner under the wrecked out back. You know, I got all these things I want to do, but my body can't keep up with my mental energy. And so my mental energy is stronger than my body for a lot of the time until I get so exhausted physically that my body crashes and it turns into a depression, because my physical body is so exhausted that I have to just... And the time that I'm relaxing, I feel so useless because there's so many things I need to do. There's so many things that I want to do that I get depressed. And then I can't get out of my own way. And for me, the only way I could get myself out of my depressions was to pull an all-nighter. Instead of sleeping 14 hours a day, I had to keep myself awake for 24 to 36 hours to pull myself out of the depression and kick myself back into overdrive. I never had midline before I started smoking weed. It was either up or down. Either I was just totally overwhelmed with all these projects, or I couldn't get out of my own way because I was too exhausted from working all these projects.
I'm working with Kennebec Behavioral, and I'm set up for a medication evaluation.
Mind if I ask you what you're taking?
I'm not taking anything.
I would suggest you not take that. My personal
opinion. Okay, that's what I was going to ask you, because if I go in there and they won't prove my medication, then I'm using marijuana. She's got hers. I haven't gotten all my stuff, but now it's legal for everybody.
Now it's legal for everybody, and which is good for you because bipolar is not a qualifying condition. Post-traumatic stress disorder.
So if I go in there and I tell them, I don't want to be prescribed medication, I want to be prescribed medical marijuana, will they do that?
Only if they agree to. You'd have to...
Because I've heard you can get it. You can get, if you're on disability, I heard you can get your medical marijuana paid for.
You can, and I can tell you how to do that. Are you familiar with Family Medicine Institute down here in Augusta? No? Who do you have for regular doctors? Do you have a regular doctor?
I got your Sumac over in Augusta.
Okay. Well, did you talk about me too?
Oh,
just regular, not for your medical marijuana.
She's not on disability on the island.
Family Medicine Institute is a clinic. It's like a family practice clinic. I've been seen since I was a little girl. I've always gone to them. Well, they now have a medical marijuana doctor on staff full-time for just that. And I get my prescription from him. It doesn't cost me a penny.
They don't make you pay for a license
nothing,
every year?
Not a penny. I don't pay for nothing.
That's what I mean.
The consult is main care paid. It's
not
a penny on
my
weed.
But what I'm saying is if I go down there and get mine, like she said.
I mean, I have to pay for my weed, but not
my
certification.
Everything.
What Dr. Sulak is doing is illegal. What the other doctors are doing is illegal. The law regarding medical marijuana, first and foremost, says that any doctor who writes a prescription for marijuana has to have a pre-existing, bona fide medical relationship with you for your qualifying condition before they can write you a prescription. So for 6 months. So in other words, Dr. Sulak legally was supposed to be your doctor for whatever condition you're getting in marijuana for 6 months before you asked him for the prescription. But he didn't do that because he sees the dollar signs. So instead, he thwarts the law, he forges his paperwork, and he charges me $300. Doctors all over the state are doing it.
Yeah, mine's about ready to be due again to come
Don't
up.
Pay it. I would call FMI, and I would call them and ask them, say, I need a general practitioner.
I do, because I haven't been to the doctor in so long, I haven't had no insurance.
Do you have main care now? No. They have, I think they have charity pay or something, but call them up and say, I need to have a general practitioner. And then when you go in for your first appointment, tell them.
Where are they out of?
Augusta. Right down by where the hospital used to be. It's 20 past 11. And while you're in there having your first consult with your general practitioner, I'll give you the phone number too.
What is it, Maine what?
Family Medicine Institute. You can tell them that you're a current medical marijuana patient and you want to see the doctor at FMI.
And even if we don't...
Now, you said you don't have disability. How are you getting your...
I have... Well, I don't get paid for it, but I have degenerative disc disease.
Okay.
And I have ulcerative colitis, which...
Because Dr. Wojtowicz is his name. W-O-Y-T-O-W-I-C-Z. Wojtowicz.
W-O-Y-T-O-W...
I-C-Z or I-C-E?
Wojtowicz. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
I-C-E or I-C-Z?
I-C-Z. I-C-Z. Wojtowicz. He won't give you a prescription until he has a pre-existing relationship with you. Okay? So you have to be a patient with FMI before he will see you. And the doctor, your primary care doctor at FMI will have to see you for the degenerative disc disease, so that there are records.
No, I can't do that until I get some insurance, because they're going to want to take an MRI again and recheck everything out, because it's been a while.
Yeah, I just got diagnosed with degenerative disc disease just
neck.
November, after Thanksgiving.
And I, you know.
She suffers chronic neck problems. I've told her she ought to try to get disability.
That's quite a... I would suggest you hire a lawyer for that. And lawyers will take your case.
But they'll probably say, well, you can still work.
Yeah, well, that's... See, that, you know,
you
know
got
what
two
I,
hands and
you know what I found
you're still
out?
Able to work.
You know what I found out, though? It's a lot harder to get it for physical because so many people apply for physical. But during the 70s, people begin to apply for it for mental reasons.
I think it's more difficult to get it for mental health now than it is physical. Especially bipolar disorder and post-traumatic stress disorder. Those,
but if you
those
know,
two are
well, I don't know up here, but down in Texas, one of the things, like the way I got it took me 8 months to get disability. That's it.
Well, you're lucky because some people have to go through the process 3 and 4 times in years. I got rejected the first time I had to get an attorney to process the paperwork for me the second time, but I only got through the second time because I had a friend who worked as a disability determination specialist who told me what keywords, key phrases they were looking for. You know, she didn't tell me what to write. She just said, this is what they look for. This is what you should emphasize. This is what you explain, you know.
The piece of information that I received that I used that I believe moved it through the very first time was there was a law down in Texas about disability, and I don't know, I guess since it's disability it's a federal law, it would be a federal law, right?
Yeah,
so it's all over the nation.
Yeah,
but when considering you for disability, if you have checked into a mental hospital and been held more than twice within a 1 year period,
yeah,
it's pretty much guaranteed.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
because it proves that it interfered.
You're
with
unstable.
Your work.
Yeah, yeah, you have instability. Yeah, I have a case manager because I have housing issues. Now I don't know if you've experienced what's been going on with case management. Sounds like you have a case manager. Mm-hmm. The governor and the legislature they're just cutting the shit right out of case management services. The only people who are allowed to have case management services now are people with schizoaffective or schizophrenia, people with a history of homelessness and people with history of criminal behavior that will land them back in jail. There's only three groups of people who are allowed to have case management. And luckily for me, I have a history of homelessness because of my standing on my rights. So that qualifies me to have case management. But even people with schizoaffective and schizophrenia, they're getting kicked to the street because they don't have severe enough symptoms, and staff are getting cut. So clientele are losing their staff. Agencies, as we hear in the news, they're shutting their doors without any warning and just letting 200 or so clients just float. You know, and then we've got...
Maybe that's why what's your face is wanting to leave Maine. Lori, Laura, or Tom's wife.
So use your case manager. Get as much benefit from them as you possibly can for, you know, for the time
you can.
I think, yeah.
Because they could be taken away from
you.
Like
I said, it is good license, all this. She can take them to all this, do all this stuff. Why I can't while I'm working, you know, utilize
well,
her by the sounds of it.
We've got the corporate America's president as our president now. So he's going to do everything he can while he's in there to make it easier.
Well, if you remember that the courts are no longer courts of law, they're courts of revenue.
That's right.
That is what they are. They're courts of revenue.
So they're considered a corporation.
They are corporations.
Yeah.
Absolutely, they're corporations.
Yeah.
Did you know, probably not, that every penny that goes into a courtroom or every penny that goes into a courthouse fund is invested in 90-day treasury notes for interest and cashed out every 90 days, and the state keeps the interest? That's your money they're investing in those 90-day treasury notes and then cashing in. It's called the Court Registry Investment System. And it's sanctioned by Texas. It was started in Texas.
You know how the governor that's been
and
down there
nationwide
forever? You know how?